Welcome to Yateley. You wouldn't believe it, but it's actually the middle of August. The rain is biblical. It could well be October or November. It's cold, damp, dreary. My kit is already soaked through. At the moment, I'm cowering from the rain. I'm gunning to get out there. It's quite busy, the lake, but there are opportunities to be had around the edges. And what I'd like to try and do in the next couple of days is catch a few of these beautiful fish in Sandhurst from the margins. Now, Sandhurst, I've seen plenty of stuff on the TV, of guys fishing out in the middle and, you know, spotting out, catching fish. But what I'd like to try and do is approach it a bit differently and try and winkle some out the edges. I think it'd be a bit exciting, a bit of fun. At the moment, I feel like a caged tiger. I'm waiting to get out there and bait up, but while it's raining like this, I don't fancy trudging around. So as soon as we get a break in the weather, I'll get out around the lake and get some bait into a few spots and see if we can't start something happening. I often hear anglers say, well, isn't stalking just something you would do on a little lake, you know, intimate lakes with lily pads, and I think, no way. I've stalked big fish at Raysbury, historically, when there were only 40-odd fish in 120 acres. I've stalked fish at Burfield, which is another big lake, 100-odd acre lake. And for me, stalking on those venues is a fantastic approach. Yes, you may have to do a lot more legwork. I can think of occasion at Burfield where I walk around the lake twice in a day. So it's a big pond, it's 100 acres. It takes a long time to walk around. Second lap, I was up a tree and I saw some fish cruising along a margin. They went in along this bit of gravel, got my bag, got some bait in, they came back, they started feeding. I got a rig in and you've got to take within 2 minutes. And you think that is intensely exciting and so satisfying. You know, whereas I could have arrived, chucked out in the middle of the pond and sat there for 2 days and caught nothing. So what more could you want? It gets you fit and you see the fish and hopefully you catch one. I love this spot. It's so intimate. The water's really clear. And I think a fish just spooked through the spot then as I threw the particles in. So I'm using a bit of a mixture. I've got some sweet corn, some maples, some chopped up boilies, just crumbed up bits and pieces, some wheat, all mixed together, little bits and pieces, rather than fish boilies, which, you know, I'm a great out and out, and I love boilie fishing, but it's good to mix things up a little bit. And for margin fishing, particles is a killer method. I love it. It gives me lots of hook bait options. And just introduced some bait on this gravelly area here. This tree seems to be a good spot for the fish. They love coming through here. I haven't put too much in. I want to catch one, not feed too many. So put a little bit of bait in, and hopefully in the next half an hour or so, things might happen. There's definitely fish about. I've seen fish cruising out. There's quite a lot of weed in this bay, so it looks absolutely perfect. So that's the bait in. Time to go and have a little creep around a few other spots. For any person coming onto any new venue, whether it was your local club water or somewhere like Sandhurst, a day ticket water, try not to come with preconceived ideas. By all means, go on the internet, go on the websites and the forums and see what's happening, what swims are working well and producing fish and which baits and rigs are working well, but have an open mind. The swim that I'd like to fish at Sandhurst today, 22, is very rarely fished. There's actually grass growing in the swim. It's not a regularly fished spot because people possibly are being slaves to the usual spots like swim 10 that's producing a lot of fish. You know, be prepared to be open-minded. So keep your options open. If one of the good swims is available, say you walk around Sandhurst and the pipes is free, then give it a go for 24 hours. But if it's not happening and the fish aren't there, don't just sit there because some bloke had a big hit in here a month ago. It's not worth it.
Well,
after this morning's absolutely biblical storm, we've now got a perfect Yateley evening. There's a beautiful wind blowing, sun's out, there's nice white fluffy clouds drifting past. It looks cracking. Unfortunately, I've not managed to stalk one today. I've baited a few spots, primed them up nicely. Definitely good spots for a bite, but I've had a few fish about, but nothing's really got me going to get a rig out. So I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to set up camp here in this little swim. As I said earlier, it's quite overlooked, flicking down the edge. But before I do that, get my house up, and then I'm just going to cruise about for a couple more hours and check out the spots, because it only takes a couple of nice fish to rock up before I'll be back there with a 6-foot rod and give myself a good shout. It looks perfect out there. It's quite busy, the main area of the lake. It's interesting. I've spoken to quite a few of the guys fishing. One guy's doing fab. He's full of it. I'm in the zone. I'm smashing it. Oh, he's really, really loving it, which is great to see. But other guys are struggling. So it's by no means fishing brilliantly at the moment, but you've got to be in it to win it. But I reckon this is good for a bite tonight. I first got the fish bug when I was probably about 7. We had a fair in the village where I grew up, a little village called Wisborough Green. And I was at the fairground, and there were all these glass jars. And the deal was, if you threw a ping pong ball in the glass jar, you won a goldfish. And I won a goldfish. My goldfish lasted probably 12 hours before it went belly up. And I guess my father probably still looks back at that day and thinks, why did I lend him the 10p for that ping pong ball? That got me started on the fish keeping thing. In parallel with that, I grew up on the edge of the village, Wisborough Green, and there was a river at the bottom of our field. And I used to go down there and was fascinated by anything that lived in the water. And after my 7th birthday, I got a fishing rod, and that was the start of it. My enthusiasm fishing developed as I got older. I started catching roach, and then on one occasion I was given a loaf of bread by a chap that fished at the local river where I grew up, a guy called Bob McIsaac, and he gave me a loaf of bread and said, squeeze some of that on your hook and see what you catch. And my 3 BB onion slid away that afternoon, and I caught my first bream on the monster. It was about 4 pounds, but for me at that point, having caught rudd this big up to that point, it was jaws. And so that started an obsession with bream fishing, and I was on that all the time. Every afternoon I'd be down there with my loaf of bread and my 3 BB onion float, which had to sit against a lily that I'd marked as the best spot in the river for bream. When the lily was gone, I was lost. Somewhere along the line, I went down to the river with my, I had a bit of a secret carp bait, which I'll let you into. I discovered, because I'd read a book on coarse fishing, that carp like bread and sweet corn. So I came up with the bright idea that if you put a bit of sweet corn on the hook as well as your bread flake, you might catch a carp. So I went down and I fished against the same old lily pad, and it slid away, and I got smashed to pieces by this carp. First carp I'd ever hooked. I remember being so traumatized by the experience, I burst into tears. 2 hours later, my grief was replaced with overwhelming joy, because I landed my first carp, and it was about 6.5 pounds. It was a little mirror carp, and that started a lifelong interest, really. I thought, wow, that was something else. I want to catch some more of them. Well, it's a super atmospheric Yateley evening, and as you can hear from the rooks in the trees behind me, it's dusk. They're coming into roost, and I've got myself set up for the night as well. I've flicked two rods out, position them either side of this little swim. I've got sweet corn on the right hand side and a balanced tiger on the left hand side tonight. Been a tricky old day. We had the monsoon from hell this morning, which wiped out all of the morning. By the time we actually got ourselves into some sort of gear, it was getting a bit late. And certainly 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, not very good for catching fish, particularly around the edges. So there we go. But on the positive note, just on dusk, I definitely had fish feeding on a couple of margin spots. I think I'm feeling quite well set up for tomorrow. Who knows? I might have one in the morning to show you before a bit of stalking tomorrow. Fingers crossed. Thank you. Well, there we go. I've just slipped that absolute chestnut of a common carp back. And the posse of swans have come over to congratulate me on my biggest ever Sandhurst carp. Hello, lads. Thank you. Yes, I'm delighted. Anyway, I caught that fish on my right-hand rod, which was just flicked round the edge of the swim. I just got in with the waders and placed it down there. And just 3 grains of sweet corn straight out the can. A little size 8 hook, perfect little trap, little drop-off lead. It all worked a treat. Nice scrap come in. I thought it wasn't as big as that. Just over 29 pound. I was guessing it looked like a 20 pounder, but actually when I got it out in the sling, I thought, hello, this one feels fantastic. What beautiful fish, really chocolate brown, big fins, huge great tail, perfect mouth. I'm very, very happy about that. Anyway, that's really lit the fire. I came here yesterday, and in the monsoon, I was vowing to try and catch one out the edge for the cameras. Can't really count last night's fish, although it was my biggest one out of Sandhurst. It wasn't exactly caught for camera. So yeah, I think it's time to get around the pond now and see if I can't winkle one out the edge for you. This bit of margin looks perfect for stalking. A lovely gravelly run just on the edge of one of the fishing swims. The gravel's really polished. It looks like the fish have been using it a fair bit. I try and avoid the sort of siltier areas where the leaves look black on the bottom. I'm trying to look for something a bit cleaner. This is one such area. I think it's worth putting a bit of bait in. You're going to better see that. So stalking does accelerate your learning. I'm a great believer in that. When you cast out into the middle of the pond, you pick your area because it looks right. You have a plumb about, you find an area to fish, you put your rigs out, and you might see fish showing over your spot first light and you don't get a bite. And you reel and think, okay, that wasn't right. Maybe I've got to choose a different rig, or maybe you'd been fishing a pop-up and you needed to fish a bottom bait. Maybe you're fishing a white hook bait and you needed to fish a brown hook bait. So chopping and changing. But that's happening over quite a long period. And okay, really good anglers are better at fine tuning quickly. But you know, I find with stalking, you can set a trap, you can watch fish come in, clear you out and leave your hook bait, and you think, okay, I didn't get that right, and you can chop and change. So you're learning, so it's like carp fishing, but in double time. It's like fast forward. So you think, right, bait on the spot, fish come in, brilliant, how exciting, I've got fish feeding on my spot, wait for them to go out, put your rig in, they come back in, feed, and then they drift out and you don't get a bite. You think then, okay, something wasn't right, so we're fine-tuning it, we'll try this, try that. Maybe 4 grains of sweet corn is too big a stack, it's too obvious, make it 2 grains, make it 1 grain, be really bold. Half a boilie maybe, rather than a boilie, or 2 boilies might get you a quick bite. So it gives you an ability to chop and change things very fast. And from a personal point of view, I think, for me, I've learned a great deal of stalking. And if you haven't given it a go, I highly recommend buy a pair of Polaroids, put some bait at the edge and see if you can get some fish feeding, because you will learn so much about the way your quarry feeds, how they behave, and hopefully how to catch them. I've walked around the lake a couple of times today, trickling bait in a few spots, just about to roll over and give up, thinking, nah, it's not looking good, maybe I should be fishing out in the middle. I'll check one of my little spots in a corner, wallop, it's black with fish. Fingers crossed, I'm gonna go and get a rig in as quick as I can. Hopefully I can lure it in amongst the fish without disturbing them too much. See if we can't catch one. There's a cracking big fish sitting right by the spot. Little drop off in lines. It's a weedy swim. I don't want the fish charging out from the edge, ploughing into a weed bed and getting stuck up with a lead. So I'm going to drop this hopefully straight away. Going to get this in and try and lower it in. It's very tricky. The fish are right on the top of me at the moment. This could be ultra close range. With my pulse going in my temples, it's never a good sign. I'm sure it's not good for your health, this business, but my God, it's exciting. Fish on the spot. His tail's up and his head is in the gravel. He's about 4 to 6 inches to the left of the bait. Estimated weight, 17 pounds. He's feeding hard, dorsals twisting back and forth. And breathe. Bigger now. Now there's two. What's a mirror? Can you see them? Come on, come on, come on. They're over the top, they're on the right of the rig now. Second fish has come up, he's right on the rig now. Come on, baby. Oh my God. There's a proper one in there, Joe. This is the point where you start thinking, did the rig twist? Did the hook go over or something wrong? It's solid carp. Almost a bit too chaotic now.
Oh my God, that was tense stuff. Amazing. Well, there you go. One absolutely smashing fish. Another beautiful Sandhurst Common. Mid 20 this time, not as big as the first one, but more importantly, I caught it right out the edge, and it's a lively one too. Wow, I am dead pleased with this one. Really, really chuffed to catch it for the camera. Anyway, the good news is I've still got another night, so fingers crossed, I might just make it three.
Yes!
Well, what a cracking day. I bloody love this game of carp fishing. Started with a 29 pounder first thing this morning, and then I managed to stalk a 26 for the cameras. So I'm absolutely chuffed with that. It's been a corker. So it's a really moody Yateley evening. The clouds are coming over. There's hardly a breath of wind. We've got a bit of drizzly rain on the lake. It looks super carpy out there. I feel I've achieved what I set out to do on this trip. I'm often asked why I go stalking. You know, what's the big crack with stalking? Well, for me, don't get me wrong, I absolutely love sitting behind rods and seeing that stow bobbin pull up tight and it's away. But there is something intensely exciting about watching your quarry come into a little spot in the edge that you baited up in crystal clear water. Seeing that fish turn, twist, its dorsal ripple, it touches the bottom, starts feeding around your rig. Those moments, you can feel the pulse going in your temples. It's absolutely addictive. Anybody I've ever taken out and said, right, let's have a go, we've caught one out the edge, they're like, whoa, I've got to do that again. That was intense to see the fish actually on the spot. And I find an hour stalking, you know, if I catch one at the end of that, it's just the most intensely, deeply satisfying and exciting way of catching a fish. I'd just say to anybody that hasn't tried it, you've got to give stalking a go.
It's the just the nature of the whole lake, really. It's the fact that it's not that pressured. The carp act as carp should act, you know. They're not influenced by anglers. It's all about me against them, really. Them in their natural environment, you know, they know it better than we do. They know the haunts. They know where they want to be for their meals at certain times and certain weather conditions. And ultimately, the fish, you know, the fish are just immense. It's a clear gravel pit where they're pretty much unmolested. You don't find fish of that quality growing on trees anymore. You know, they're special fish. They were stocked, what, 34 35 years ago originally, so they've most of them have probably been caught less than an handful of times in their life, so it's unique. You know, I'm not going to say they're unknowns, I'm not going to say that they're myths and all that kind of stuff, but they are. They've not been caught that much during their life, and there's something special about that. You know, you can't replicate that in everyday carp fishing, and it's the solitude as well as the challenge, really. It's me against the fish. I know if I don't catch, it's down to me. It's not down to anybody else. There's nobody else to blame. And the rewards are just, it doesn't matter whether it's a 15 pounder or a 35 pounder, the rewards are just immense. They're all characters that have grown up in an environment that not everybody's got access to. It just ticks all the boxes for me. On here, it's electric. You know, fishing locked up, it's weedy, it's snaggy. You never get single beat bites, you know, even fishing locked up. You're just on edge from the moment you get, even when you go to pick the rod up out of the rests, you can feel it in the back of your neck. You feel the hairs on the back of your neck stand up because you just know it's going to be explosive. You just know it's, 9 times out of 10, it's just going to be a pure power adrenaline fight, and there's not a lot to match that. Come on. That was not the rod I was expecting to go. Come on. Come on. Right, you join us in Cambridgeshire at a pretty unique, awesome venue. I got down late last night, set up in an area where I thought the fish would pass through, and for this morning, I honestly thought the chance had gone, but just as we've been sorting out, the middle rod has absolutely melted off, and after a bit of a hairy battle against them snags over there, I've managed to get this lovely old dark looking mirror away from them, and hopefully we'll have something to show you very, very soon. Come on, maybe not just yet. Come on, come on, come on. Ooh, not quite. Come on! That'll do for a start. My favourite, I think it's the same on nearly every lake I've fished, it's always that first bite, you know, because they're never easy earned. You know, the kind of lakes I love to fish, that first bite is never, yeah, occasionally you get a fluky one, don't you? But that first bite is often quite hard earned. Especially on these lower stock lakes, you know, where you're having to move around a lot, you're having to work hard to get on the fish, find the spots, learn about how they want to behave. So ultimately, it's always, the favourite moment's always that first bite. The rest of it along the way is just the journey, isn't it? The different fish will come along, different sized fish will come along, different looking fish. Some fish will blow you away purely because of the size, some it'll be because of the scale patternings or just the character or the fight. But the favourite bit for this kind of place is always that first bite, yeah.
That hurts. Just about to start sorting out the one that we've already got in the retainer, and the left hand rod's melted off. By the time I've got onto it, it's solid in the weed. Slowly changed the angle on it by wading down the margin, slowly got the pressure changed and got it moving, and then the hook's pulled. I'm wounded is probably the best way of putting that one. Ultimately, we've still got another stunner here to show you, so we'll sort that one out and hopefully that'll ease the blow a little bit.
This is why I love these big clear gravel pits. Wild waters, fairly unknown carp that absolutely love their own environment. Just look at the colours and that, look at the condition of that. This is why I do it. It's just, there's no bigger buzz. I class myself as extremely fortunate because I don't think I'll ever find anything like this again. The unknown, ultimately, the unknown, you know. Yeah, I've got a good grasp of what is in here, but there's always surprises, you know. It's so lightly fished and was stocked that long ago that you've got not only originals, you've got second generation fish, but it's the unknown, you know. There's nothing with names. Yeah, we refer to different fish by different tags, of course we do, but they're not named. You know, and most of them you can count on one, maybe two hands, the number of captures. So it's ultimately the unknown. You just never know what's on the end of that line when that buzzer goes. So that is the the real draw to these venues and this one in particular. Boating gives you just such a completely different perspective, you know. It's almost like opening something up in 3D for the first time, you know. It just gives you a whole new level. When you're from the bank, you're either elevated up a tree, obviously watching where you'll see certain things that you'll see differently from ground level. But when you get out on that surface and you break through that glare, either through your Polaroids or through a scope or whatever, your understanding of the under the surface environment is completely different. When you first start it, it honestly blows your mind a little bit, because how you read it with a rod and a lead is completely different to them views that you first get when you're drifting over spots. And I honestly think it gives you such a greater understanding of what you're feeling when you're back on the bank with a rod. You know, I think you will see the differences in spots compared to how you perceive it in your mind's eye just by drifting over it and having a look through an aquascope or through your Polaroids from above it in a boat. It just gives you such a different perspective. You know, daft things like an area we describe as the size of a bivvy ground sheet, for example, or a dustbin lid, it won't be. It'll be completely different, and it's never how we imagine it. You know, we drag a lead across a spot and we imagine it to be smooth sand or whatever. You'll get out there and it'll be sediment over gravel and things like that, and it's just completely different. And what you think is an effective spot maybe isn't as effective as you thought when you start drifting over areas in a boat. Makes your hair stand up on the back of your neck, you know. It does, genuinely. If you see one of the real big ones that you've been searching for, maybe for a couple of days in a trip, you know, if you're actively looking, you know what it's like when you're out on the bank and you see what you think is a big fish. But when you're out in the boat and you're maybe 12, 15 feet away from it at a very similar level, it's electrifying. It's absolutely electrifying, especially when you know. Sometimes you can't put weights on things, but you just know it's a big fish, and it's just so intriguing. You, without wanting to spook them, you want to get as close as you possibly can just to be able to see the scalings, to be able to see the unique features, to be able to say, actually, I recognise that one, and that's a big old fish. But it just makes the hair stand up on the back of your neck, and it makes you more alert to everything else that's going on. Going to sound so obvious, but stay away from the glaringly obvious bits. You know, when we're feeling the drop with our rods, 9 times out of 10 that's not as clear as we think it is from that transmission. That lead's falling through low-lying weed, or it's falling through sediment on top of the silt. Prime example, where we are now in the spring, you will see different colours in the sand and the sediment on the bottom. There's lighter areas and darker areas, and having seen the fish feeding, them lighter areas are areas that they've started to turn over. So they're the things that I will look for, as opposed to the glaringly obvious clear areas. That's one of the tips. The biggest one I've probably learned is not setting up on the groups of fish. It's trying to predict which way they're going to go through the behaviour that they're showing when you found them from the boat, looking at which ways they're looking at going and how they're grouped up and the weather conditions. Just trying to put yourself either side of the group to make the most of it as they move out of an area, because these kind of places, you set up directly on top of them, one lead too heavy or whatever, they drift off and then you're back to square one again. So learning how they're behaving, spend the time to watch them as they're moving around and being happy and comfortable in their environment, and just trying to put yourself one step in front of them as opposed to setting up directly on top of them. Unless obviously they're colouring it up and it's clay and chocolate, that's a different matter. But if it's a normal day and they're just in a group, quite happy, lazing around in the sun or the snags, just try and put yourself one step in front of them through how they're behaving, and try and get in front of them and get your traps set, as opposed to dropping your leads directly on top of them. I honestly believe that there's a rig for a situation, if that makes sense. I don't think there's a rig that is a go everywhere rig and a do everything rig. I don't think that exists. You know, I think
the nature of the lake bed, the nature of the spot you're trying to fish over, your baiting presentation, how you're actually baiting up the area as well, will all have an impact on the rig I'm going to use on any given day, if that makes any sense at all. You know, yeah, I've got my favourites, of course I have, but I've got rigs that I've got confidence in, but ultimately they're not chuck it out on every single spot and expect to catch rigs. You know, you've got to tailor it to the situation you find yourself fishing in. What gives me confidence in a rig is previous kind of captures over different areas, different types of lake bed and stuff like that, and ultimately ones that give me flexibility to make them adaptable to suit the situations that I'm in. On here particularly, I tend to fish links a lot longer than I would do most places because of the nature of the lake bed that I'm fishing over. You know, yeah, there is some really kind of clean areas that I would shorten things down on, but the majority of the areas that I'm looking to fish on, I don't want to be fishing on the mega shiny gravel. I want to be fishing on the dirty, low-lying weed areas. So one of the biggest things is lengthening off my rigs to get the right presentation. If you've ever cast out from the bank and then drifted over it in a boat, it does look completely different to how you would imagine it, which is why I think to my mind, that's why you make them changes to your rigs. We're all looking for that dream hook hold, aren't we? That's like half an inch back, bottom lip, bang in the centre. And that's what we're all aiming for, because that's the most secure part to get an hook hold in. So that's what we're all aiming for, isn't it? We want that hook hold to be as secure as possible. This morning's kind of activity blew that picture, to be honest. The only rod I was expecting to go this morning was the right-hand rod, and obviously the bites came on the left and the middle. What I would anticipate off the back of the weather today, I would anticipate the middle and the right-hand rods to go in dark, if any are going to go in the dark, and be the left-hand rod into daylight tomorrow, judging by what we've kind of seen for the weather, because the left-hand rod's back up the shallower water, moving back through to the shallows. I'd expect that to be the last one to go if they follow form, really. I've got no doubts about being in the right area for tonight, not from what I saw from the boat earlier. You know, the fish were still clearly in the area, the spots had been cleaned off from yesterday's baiting, and the area where I thought they might have gone to and I was probably questioning in my own head about a move to didn't show any signs for me to make me move down there. So yeah, I'm confident I'm still in the right area for tonight. Well, it's the second morning now, and let's just say last night didn't exactly go according to plan. I've had a couple of bites and both have come adrift, unfortunately. This swim, I've landed everything I've hooked in before, and I had a bit of a wobble about whether I should stay or move, purely because I'd lost two on the trot. I've made a couple of changes now, and I'm confident that those changes will lead to the next bite being securely in the net, so let's see how we get on.
There's one just shown probably a rod length behind the middle rod. And judging by the size of the shoulders, it weren't a little fish. So I'm really on edge now, really on edge. I think I'm even gonna go sit right down next to the rods just in case. I'm sat as patiently as possible because they keep showing over the middle rod. There's been four shows now in probably the last half an hour, 40 minutes, and there's been a couple of liners as well. I've been deliberating as to whether I should recast it because there's been enough activity over there to make me think I should have had a bite. Is it tangled or is my presentation right? But the drop was right, the rig went out right in flight, so I'm going to give it a little bit longer and see what happens. But it is looking good. It is looking good, it's just frustrating. I just want that bite, it's just frustrating now. There's that's what, six, seven shows now in the last hour or so. And as much as I'm 99.9% happy that rig landed right, I've got to do something. That's just like I should have had a bite. The weather's spot on, it's the same as yesterday. It's fish in the area, it just feels like I should have had a bite, so I've got to try and force the issue a little bit. So I'm going to recast just to make sure that rig is out there properly and doing what it should be doing. So. Right, it's got to midday, it's gone baking hot. I think the chance of the bite for the day is gone now, so I'm gonna get off searching for a few and see if we can find a few that we can go have a go for. No way! You are joking me. I've just been saying about the time of day and all the rest of it, just been reeling my rods in, and the last rod red in the last rod left in the water is ripped off. Right. Hopefully, we'll get this one in the net for you. Come on, baby. Come on. Ooh. I can't believe that. I really, really cannot believe that. Come on, baby. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Good girl. Good girl. Come on. Ooh. Cheers, mate.
Come on. That's it. Stay out there. Come on, that's it. Keep coming. Keep coming. Keep coming. Oh, just felt that kick over its dorsal with a braided main line. Come on. Come on. Oh, here she goes. Here she goes. Oh, come on. Come on. Get in! Finally. Oh, Jesus Christ. Oh, wicked. Come on! You would not believe how happy I am to get that one in the net. That is absolutely awesome. I'm so pleased to get that one in the net. So pleased to get that one in the net. I'm just gonna secure her in the net and then we'll get sorted and let you have a look. Man.
You know, there's the tranquility, it's kind of like a mind reset as well. You get away from the stresses of everyday life and work and all the rest of it. But ultimately, it's the buzz. Every time one of them buzzers goes, you never know what you're going to be up to, you know? The fights are always electric, the bites are always electric. And it's just an ultimate buzz. It's just an awesome rush. Not fishing for named fish is, yeah, it's just, I just don't think you can match it. It's just that, the whole buzz, you know, it's the whole journey along the way. You have the ups, the downs, which we've had, you know, you get the highs and the lows, it's fishing. But ultimately that reward, it doesn't matter what the way, that reward when it's in the net, just like, it's just immense. It's just that buzz.
There we go, 21 pound 12 ounce of stunning mirror carp. One of the many, many reasons why I come to this place. After the tribulations and trials of the last day or so, I'm so pleased to catch this carp, so pleased. Just goes to show you can go through all the theory, think you've done everything right, but sometimes when it boils down to fishing, it is just that, it's fishing. And when your luck's in, and I'm so pleased mine finally held.
There's a couple of things that kind of really, really tick the boxes, you know. It's the challenge, and the challenge is probably the biggest one, but it's not about pounds and ounces with these fish. It's about age, history, heritage, how they look. They're all characters, you know, and that combined with the challenge of actually catching them is, they're the two biggest things, mate. I mean, it's, to me, I don't think I'll ever find anywhere like this again in my fishing career. You know, I class myself as very fortunate to have found somewhere like this, and I don't think they grow on trees, and I don't think I'll find anywhere like it again. You know, it's unique. That's the best way of putting it, it's unique.
Welcome to Cleveley Top Lake. This is one of the syndicates I've been fishing for the last few years.
done a couple of winters on this lake. At times it's been grueling, but I've had quite a lot of success as well. So I'm going to talk about that with you. Got down yesterday, had a £20 common last night, then moved swims. This is my second move of the day. The lads have come down, and we're going to talk through what's been going on. I started fishing it to target the big mirror in here, which at the time was about 41, 42 pound. At the moment, it's about 47. A couple of my mates have been lucky enough to catch it, and it's a real stunning fish. Some of my other success on here has mostly been in the winter, so a lot of this will be geared around that. But just lately, I've turned fishing it in the summer because I've really got the bit between my teeth now, and I want to see that fish in the bottom of my landing net. From up a tree, you should learn something about it. Why is it in the area? What's it doing? When it gets caught, where did it come from? If you know, what was the guy doing? Did it do that twice in a row? It's come out of the swim. It's come out the same swim every spring almost for 8 years. There, straight away, is a habit, you know what I mean? Then it'll do, it very rarely comes off of a middle swim, you know, so things like that. So you start to build a picture of where this fish feeds, what it does, what fish were with it. Were the fish with it in front of it or behind it? If they're in front of it, it's most likely, because it don't get caught like, it's because they're getting in most of the time. So there's lots of things you can learn from watching fish, targeting fish. And then when you do catch that fish, and you've done it off of something you've learned, and you've put the jigsaw together, and it's in the net, that's the ultimate buzz. That's what was giving the ultimate buzz. Don't get me wrong, I want to catch them other fish, but ultimately, I want the big one, you know, because I want it myself. Not for a magazine, not to make it famous, just for myself, you know, I just want to catch it. I've been fishing for carp now about 31, 32 years. And I never get bored because everyone's a different character. They look different individually. I know they're all the same species, but you know, a mirror can be a linear, a fully scaled. And then you set yourself like personal goals. I like to set myself a target. And that might even be something as silly as like in a winter, I might want to catch 20 20s. So I go to a walk with lots of 20s and I set myself little goals. And then sometimes I set myself difficult goals. I'm not afraid to fail. I set myself a target, I accept that I may fail it, but I'm going to have a good go at passing, you know. And then it's what happens between the start and the finish that makes the story. My body's breaking in two. Plus it's all I'm getting sick and tired. sometimes I might see a picture in a magazine, or like, you know, or on Facebook I might see a picture come down and think, where's that from? Or even someone will tell you, there goes this lake, and I love a challenge, I go, it's so hard, you know, you don't bother fishing it if you've only got one night a week, and then that's like a red rag to a bull. Come here like 12, 15 years ago, the whole place was surrounded by trees in the water, and he took the fish out of here when they'd been in here a year and put them into the mere where they grew on, but obviously there was some left and he stopped others as well, and it became a bit of a runs water, so he took all the snags out, got divers in, and you could come up here for a bite. But then what happened, it had an oxygen crash and they lost probably 75% of the fish, and Ben did buy some other fish, Dinton pastures, babies. And he managed to get a couple of fish from a guy who had a pond on his house. One of them happened to be, I think, £22, and that was what went on to be called geezers. Yeah, I can describe her. She's got about three or four scales splattered along her dorsal lateral line either side. It's quite a long fish with a dip in her back. And when you see her from up a tree, she rarely looks as big as she is until she turns front on. And then you realise when you see the width of it, what fish it is. But it's got a perfect mouth, about the size of a teacup. I've seen it on the bank once. It's a strange carp, really. It gets caught a lot by lads within their first session. And twice now, two lads have caught it. We've had one carp all year, so their whole season. And on their last night, and they've caught it. And good, to be honest, fair play to them, you know what I mean? It's good, that's good for them, you know? Like, when they've caught it, I thought, shit, I've had all them fish, you know, and had it. But that's how it goes, you know? When your time comes, it comes. I'm happy for them, and when I have it, I hope they're happy for me. Yeah, that rig that I've used a lot on here, it's simple. It's the blowback rig. But all I do, I use quite a long hair with it, and I always make sure it's balanced. So you get a good drop on the hook. Very rarely get a hook pull on it. Well, 24 hours into the session, now on my third move. Nothing was happening in that last swim. They were there this morning, but they'd done you off. Found a couple of fish patrolling the reed line here. One of them looked a good fish as well, so I've got round here. I must be confident because I've got the bivvy up. So we'll see what happens here. Basically, I've got to feel it down. If I can feel it and there's a bit of a donk or put like soft silt or something like that, I'm happy to put like the hinge stiff rig or the El Grey rig in there. If it's thick weed or really stodgy, crappy bottom, then I'll put in the chod rig. Recently done well in here on longer hook lengths rather than short. I've just noticed just through, you know, experimentation, longer hook lengths have been giving me more bites. Going back to the Walthamstow days when I was fishing in West Warwick, we was using 18-inch nylon hook links, and not just catching because of it, we was catching well, like out fishing everyone on them. So like there was definitely sank in it, and I think it was all to do with clearance of the bottom, you know, like pushing that bait out as well away from the lead, so you're getting a nice clean presentation. I'm not the kind of angler that has two rigs in his armoury. I've got whatever it takes, I'll do. You know what I mean? There ain't no limit. I'll just put on what needs to be put on. I think when I catch geezers, it's probably going to be unexpected. I'm going to turn up, cast out, be getting ready and it'll go. Because that's 9 times out of 10 how it gets caught. And I'm really mindful of that, to when I get here, spend a few hours just fishing rather than smashing the place to pieces with spots and markers. So, yeah, a lot of the time I'll just put my rods in. I'm sort of just trying to prepare for that capture. But I've had a million different ways I'm going to catch it. You know, when you're after a fish, you think, oh, I think I'll have it out of that area. And 9 times out of 10, you always end up getting them in an unexpected way, like. But as long as the hook's sharp and the rigs are good, landing it's what's important. This morning, probably around 6-ish, it's turned over, the left hand rod, which I've got locked out, it's just hooped round. I thought, that ain't no coop. So I stepped off the edge there with a net and I waded out to about chest deep. Eventually I managed to get it wallowing on the surface, scooped it up, and see if it was fully scaled. You know, when you're fishing locked up, everything's angry from the second the alarm goes, you know what I mean? Even when your net is, like, so yeah, it's good fun. There's two fully scaled here, one's about £20 and then there's the big one, which is a lovely fish. It's not actually a fully scaled, it's more just got these massive armour plated scales all over it. As people were saying are watching this, a lovely fish, got like a really short rudd like mouth on it and fights like stink, you know what I mean? It really did go for it. That bite was probably one of them fish that I saw from up the tree. Yesterday when we come into the swim and we was looking for a move, we saw them two fish patrolling down that reed line and they looked about £30, so I've no doubt that was one of the ones. We've spotted him, set a trap. Later on in the session he's come and fell to it. But when I reeled in, I noticed the chop that I was using, the rudd had just destroyed it, there was nothing left. So I got out some baits, some IBs that I'd had soaking in goo for like ages, and they end up going really hard. So I put one of them down there, fishing my normal hybrid over the top. And yeah, it stood the test of time really, because the rub would have been all over it without that. And yeah, the rig was the same again, £20 hook link, stiff, size 6 hook on a blowback, really strong. But when I put the bait down there, I didn't overfeed it. I probably put about 20 boilies. So it was, I'm looking for a bite, you know. And then over the course of the evening, it got cooler. And when the temperature dropped down, I did hear quite a good fish crash around the corner of the reeds, which to me was a signal that they were in the mood for a bit of feeding. So yeah, the temperature dropping definitely brought on a bit of a, you know, feeding spell. If you're on them, that's as much as you can do. A decent rig, good bait, get on the fish. Consistency is key to catching carp. If you're consistent in what you do, you'll get results. There's not much left of the session, but I'm happy, you know, you can't moan at a £31 fully scaled. And that's fish number 62 now. Hunt's gonna carry on. I'm gonna keep going, and eventually I'm gonna catch it. And I ain't giving up till I do, and that's it, end of.